Good morning to everyone assembled here. Firstly, I would like to express my deep gratitude to the Government of India, Information and Broadcasting Affairs for nominating me in the state of Karnataka to be with you here today and to discuss and to bring awareness, to generate awareness about the actually three major laws, but I have been interested with the BNSS 2023. Which have passed by the parliament by replacing the CRPC, that is IPC, CRPC, and Indian Evidence Act has been replaced by the parliament. So at the outset, I would like to say that I am at absolute delight to be here with PIB Bangalore and their audience. Apart from that, at the outset, I would also like to make it a note that today's assembly here is only to discuss with regard to the three major laws. So I submit and I request all the esteemed guests who are present here to restrain and constrain themselves to ask questions and for the discussion only with regard to the three major laws, because you are all from press media. So we should be restrained ourselves and constrained ourselves only to discuss these three major laws. Let us now take up a subject. Before I start, I feel that some words of preface are required. No issues. The very precise purpose of this program is to acquire and to accumulate at least some knowledge and to generate awareness in the general public with regard to the BNSS 2023. Now, you all very well aware that IPC, which is known as Indian Penal Code, which is replaced by BNS, Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita. Likewise, BNSS, Bharatiya Nagarika Suraksha Samhita 2023, and BSA, Bharatiya Saksha Adhiniyama 2023. So the whole intention of the legislature is based upon the, it is mainly centered on justice-centric and victim-centric. The Nyaya Samhita is Nyaya Vyavaste, Danda Samhita and Danda Prakriya was punishment-based laws which were there in the colonial era. That is what I would like to start with. Now, law is a lifeline. You all know that law is a lifeline for every citizen of India. We are bound by the law. We should also have the knowledge about law. So this law is an important instrument for prevention and control of crime. All the laws which we are dealing with has a instrument. It is an instrument for prevention and control of crime. As I have said, some words of preface are required before venturing into the discussion. But I would like to say that I am not going to enlighten you all with section-wise, clause-wise. We will only discuss what are the structural changes which has been brought by the parliament. Likewise, what is the conceptual changes? For example, in which section philosophy itself has changed? Some sequence has been changed, some reorganization has been done. There are some provisions which the concept itself has been changed. There are some other provisions also wherein philosophy of the provision itself has been changed. So as I have told, we will discuss the matter only with regard to the conceptual and philosophical changes. The earlier laws were of colonial era, legislated by the colonial souls. Whenever any laws are enacted or amended or new legislations were brought into force, we have to check certain principles. Whether the laws entail a justification or not has to be looked into at the outset. Legislated criminal policy must cater and respond to the societal and contextual need and necessity. Particularly these three major laws which were passed by the parliament is 150, the earlier colonial era laws were of 150 year old, this one. CRPC has been amended several times, but it is in piecemeal of justice. And justice shall be the ultimate objective, and emphasis is always on justice and nothing else. The criminal law shall uphold the principles or spirit of our constitution. So what I mean to say here is, whichever the laws are passed or whatever laws are amended, enacted or changed, it should always uphold the spirit of our Indian constitution. So as of here, justice centric, but not the punishment. As the name of these laws, as I already told you, it is Nyaya Samhita, Nyaya Dand at large. So primacy of the Indian interest is there in these laws. So adherence to Indian constitutional values is also there. These are the laws passed and legislated by our own parliament, not by the colonial. You all to the major reforms carried out in BNSS 2023. Always, whenever a book is written or any enactment is passed, amended, what we will see is the definition clause. Earlier in CRP, introduction of technology is introduced, that is law to deal with the proclaimed offenders, that is trial inquiry in absentia, Timeline for speedy justice is introduced. Reforms in trial procedures are also introduced. Always worked in the interest of victims' interest to give them justice and also to the state. I am more concerned about the victim. Say that the laws are victim-centric. It is nothing but we are empowering the victims, isn't it? What empowerment or what rights have been given to the victims, we will deal now in detail. The new law aims to enhance the efficiency, fairness and accountability of the justice system. It recognizes the victim as a stakeholder in the criminal trial, providing participatory rights and expanded right to information for the victim. The law reforms to place victim at the center of the criminal justice system, offering unprecedented rights and opportunities. So when I'm concentrating on the rights of the victim, I would like to recall the judgment passed by the Honorable Supreme Court in Jagdeep versus Ashish Mishra. In that, Honorable Supreme Court has very clearly declared that the victim has got unbridled participatory rights. So on that basis, she has been given, or a victim has been given participatory rights, right to information and right to compensation for the harm suffered. So these are the rights which has been given to the victim. Apart from this, if you will see CRPC, that is BNSS 2023, BNS 2023, as well as BSA 2023, some protection has also been given to the victim. So I will deal it in the later stage. Now let me take you in detail with regard to the right to participation. Victims now have the right to express their views, reinforcing their role as a stakeholder in the criminal cases. The institutionalization of zero FIRs and the introduction of eFIRs enhance accessibility, allowing victims to file reports anywhere irrespective of the crime location. Earlier, the victim, if in case she has to lodge a FIR, she ought to have visited the jurisdictional police station only, not in any other police station. So now that aspect has been totally changed. Anywhere in the country, she can file a FIR, which is known as a zero FIR. So that FIR will be transferred to jurisdiction, the police station. Apart from that, within 3 days, she has to go to the police station, concerned police station, and she has to sign that FIR. This is whenever the investigation has to begin, FIR is a must. So the kickstart of investigation will be after registration of FIR. So this FIR can be lodged anywhere in India. It is not necessary that she has to visit the police station only. So this is how a victim has given a very major right to file, lodge the FIR. Now let me take your attention. See, when I'm taking up this BNSS 2023 for discussion, as you all of know that investigation starts after registration of FIR. Likewise, there are certain stages. That is, first and the foremost requirement is to set law into motion, registration of FIR. Thereafter, investigation. So, investigation has certain procedures to visit the scene of occurrence of the place. Likewise, recording of the statement of the witnesses. Then other procedures also there. Thereafter, once the investigation is completed, charge sheet will be laid before the court. Thereafter, trial will start before the court. So, let me take step-wise so that you can understand the concept very easily. As I have told, so in certain places, law is also justice-based and timeline trial is also ensured to achieve conviction rate of 90% through the introduction of electronic evidence, forensic evidence and other things. Now, let me take to the other aspects of FIR, wherein these FIRs can also be filed in online mode without having to visit police station in person. The FIR system is designed to be more efficient and convenient as it eliminates the need for people to travel to the police station and wait a long queue to file a complaint. So the system also allows people to track the status of their complaint. Earlier it was not possible under CRPC to track the status of the FIR. Now section wise, let me take how rights under BNSS is recognized. Information in cognizable cases. After institutionalization of the FIR and introduction of eFIR, enhanced accessibility allowing victims to file reports anywhere irrespective of the crime location, and these FIRs should be given to the victims. It should be supplied to the victim. The under section 179, police officers' power to require attendance of witnesses, no male person under the age of 15 years or above the age of 60 years, or a woman or a mentally or physically disabled person or a person with acute illness shall be required to attend at any place other than the place in which such person resides. So earlier this was not having place in CRPC. Now the police person cannot call these victims to the police station who are under the age of 15 years and above the age of 60 years and also a woman. This is another kind of protection which has been given to the victims. Likewise, in section 290 of the BNSS, application for plea bargaining. The court is satisfied that the application has been filed by the accused voluntarily. It shall provide time not exceeding 60 days to the public prosecutor or the complainant of the case. Complainant of the case means here always a victim. Complainant of the case and the accused to work out mutually satisfactory disposition of the case, which may include giving to the victim by the accused the compensation and other expenses during the case, and thereafter fix the date for further hearing of the case. So, again, the right of participation has been given in plea bargaining by the legislature. Likewise, earlier in complaint cases, the accused would be discharged when a complaint was absent. Complaint case means it is not a FIR case. It is a complaint, private complaint, what we call it as a private complaint, PCR. Now, the revised section 272 of BNSS gives an opportunity for complainant to be adequately represented, as the magistrate can give 30 days time to the complainant to be present before the discharging, before discharging the accused. So this recognition was not there in CRPC earlier. Now before discharging or before discharging the accused or before, that is what the opportunity should be given to the complainant also by the courts. This is another recognition given by BNSS 23 to the victim. So apart from that, If you look into BNS, the new law, that is justice based, not punishment based, that's what I have already told you. In this furtherance, it recognizes the victim as a stakeholder. Earlier it was not there. Stakeholders were like prosecution, police, judiciary, and the correctional centers were the stakeholders. Now victim has been given, recognized as an important stakeholder in BNS. Hence, the new law is victim-centric law, and for this purpose, these new sections are added. Now coming to the BSA. BSA is Bharatiya Saksha Adhiniyama. The participation right, the information right, as well as the protection is not only given under BNSS, it is also given under BNS as well as BSA. Now let me take you all to the BSA, how protection has been given to the victim of rape. According to this new BSA, it has kept up the technological advancement and social changes of the past decade. Therefore, BSA is enacted as per the Act. It aims to consolidate and to provide the general rules and principle of evidence for fair trial. Now, as per Section 48 of BSA, character or previous sexual experience not relevant in certain cases. Whenever a victim of rape has been put into the witness box, the cross-examination was it is embarrassing for the victim to go through the cross-examination. It was nothing but second victimization, I can say. So with regard to the previous sexual experience, that there cannot be any cross-examination or question. This is what under Section 48 of the BSA has replaced the earlier law. Now let me take what are the rights which have been given to the victim as a right to information. Under Section 360 of BNSS, it aims to fill the historical void in Section 321 of CRPC. As you all know that 321 of CRPC earlier was a withdrawal from the prosecution. That authority or power was given to the public prosecutor who is conducting the case can withdraw the case, prosecution case. But now BNSS has replaced that withdrawal power without hearing victim. So information to the victim is also given before withdrawal. So that is the information which has been included under BNSS. Likewise, under Section 174 of BNSS, information as to non-cognizable cases and investigation of such cases, as per Clause 1, Clause 2, police officer will forward the daily diary report of all such cases fortnightly to the magistrate. Even in the non-cognizable cases, the victim will have a information. Even if it is a non-cognizable offense, she will have or he will have what is the status of the investigation. So as under Section 360, no court shall allow such withdrawal without giving an opportunity of being heard to the victim in the case. Likewise, Section 193, subclause 3H, subclause 2, report of a police officer on completion of investigation. As I have told, there are stages in the criminal registration of crime and investigation, thereafter trial. Now, after registration of the crime, investigation will be carried out by the police. And on completion of investigation, he will file a final report. So whenever such final report is prepared, the police officer shall within a period of 90 days inform the progress of the investigation by any means, including through electronic communication to the informant or the victim. This was not at all there earlier in CRPC. So the person, one who is a victim, without having the evidence what has been collected by the IVO, will not know his case at all. If in case he is having a whole evidence which is collected by the investigating officer, at least he or she will come to know that what are the evidences collected by the IO and where his case stands in the future. So that has been made mandatory under BNSS to supply the charge sheet, what we will call it as a charge sheet copy or a final report to the victim also. along with this, I can also take you how BNSS has introduced the technology in regard to the information. Under Section 230, supply to accused of copy of police report and other document, provided further that if the magistrate is satisfied that any such document is voluminous, he shall, instead of furnishing the accused and the victim, if represented by an advocate, with a copy thereof, may furnish the copies through electronic means or direct that he will only be allowed to inspect it either personally or through an advocate in court, provided also that supply of documents in electronic form shall be considered as duly firm. It is not necessary that if the final report or the charge sheet is voluminous, it is not necessary that the hard copy need to be given to the victim or the accused. Even through electronic media or electronically, those copies can be supplied to the accused as well as the victim. So in VNS, under Section 65, medical expenses and rehabilitation of the victim is introduced, which was not there earlier in VNS, that is in IPC. Under Section 176(1)(b), procedure for investigation has been laid down. If it appears to the officer in charge of a police station that there is no sufficient ground for entering on an investigation, he shall not investigate the case, provided further that in relation to an offence of rape, the recording of statement of the victim shall be conducted at the residence of the victim or in the place of her choice, and as far as practicable, by a woman police officer in the presence of her parents or guardian or near relatives or social worker of the locality, and such statement also be recorded through the audio, video, electronic means, including mobile phone. So this was not there earlier. Whenever a victim of rape is there, she used to be summoned to the police station and she used to be interrogated or questioned by the police officer in the police station itself. That is now replaced by the BNSS, and the police officer, woman police officer, has to visit the rape victim's house in front of the parents or guardian or before a social worker. Such statement need to be recorded, and that statement can be recorded audio, video mode also. So this is another protection which has been given to the victim in under BNSS. Now in BNS, under Section 70, fine imposed shall be paid to the victim. So whenever there is a punishment, the fine amount should be given to the victim. That is another section which has been included in BNS. Under Section 70, subclause 2, disclosure of identity of victim of certain offences, etc., is not permitted. For example, nothing in subsection 1 extends to any printing or publication of the name or any matter which may make known the identity of the victim, if such printing or publication is by or under the order in writing of the officer in charge of the police station or the police officer making the investigation into such offence, acting in good faith for the purposes of such investigation by or with the authorization in writing of the victim, where the victim is dead or a child or of unsound mind, by or with the authorization in writing of the next of kin of the victim, provided that no such authorization shall be given by the next of kin to anybody other than the chairman of the secretary by whatever name called of any recognized. See, we all very well aware that it is very, very important for you people. Before publication, you cannot disclose the identity of the victim under POCSO Act or a victim of rape. This is a responsibility on all the people who are gathered here today. You cannot disclose the identity of the victim of rape and also the child under POCSO Act. Under BNS, under Section 77, voyeurism, explanation 1 and 2. Now let me take you to the explanation. For the purpose of this section, private act includes an act of watching carried out in the place which, in the circumstances, would reasonably be expected to provide privacy and where the victim's genitals, posterior or breast, are exposed or covered only in underwear, or the victim is using a lavatory, or the victim is doing a sexual act that is not of a kind ordinary done in the public. Then explanation two is where the victim consents to the capture of the images or any act, but not to their dissemination to third persons, and where such image or act is disseminated, such dissemination shall be considered an offence under this section. Sexual act that is not of any kind ordinarily done in public. So explanation two is where the victim consents to the capture of the images or any act, but not to the dissemination to third persons, and where such image or act is. So these kind of acts cannot be displayed by any person. So protection has been given under BNS. So affording further protection to the victims of rape, it has been mandated in section 183 subclause 6 subclause A that their statement shall be recorded only by a lady judicial magistrate, and in her absence by a male judicial magistrate in the presence of a woman. So now earlier 164 statement, you all very well know that 164 statement of the victim has been recorded in POCSO Act or under victim of rape. Earlier in the BNSS has not made that these 164 statement ought to have been recorded by a woman judicial officer, but this BNSS has made it mandatory upon the courts that these 164 statement of the victim should be recorded by the judicial magistrate, that is a lady judicial magistrate. If in case in absence of lady woman officer, in the presence of a woman, that statement can be recorded by the male judicial officer. So this is again a protection given under BNSS to the victim. So in BNS, section 143 is voluntarily causing hurt by use of acid attack. Likewise, section 143, trafficking of a person. In under this 143 trafficking of a person, explanation 2 has been added by the BNS. The consent of the victim is immaterial in determination of the offense of trafficking. So you all know that TIP Act, Immoral Prevention of Immoral Trafficking Act, is there. In that earlier this was not found place in BNS. Now even if there is a consent of the person who is been trafficked, that is immaterial. We cannot say that she has given consent for traffic. That has been taken out and protection has been given to the victim. Section 200, punishment for non-treatment of victim. Have you ever found such a provision in IPC? Punishment for non-treatment of the victim. So responsibility has been given to the doctors also, that if in case a victim has been hospitalized, she has to be treated on priority. Otherwise, there is a punishment clause under BNS for that. So under BNS also, this protection has been given to the victim. Certain rigorous punishments have been introduced by the BNS with regard to the offences against women. Section 66, punishment for causing death or resulting in persistent vegetative state of victim. Can anyone recall the case in which a person who is a victim has been victimized in a vegetative mood?
There was a woman, something, she died 2 months back. Was in vegetative state for more than 10 minutes.
Yes.
That anesthesia was wrongly administered to her in Mulligan Nursing.
Other than this, any landmark decision of the Honorable Supreme Court? Have you ever heard Aruna Shanbhag, sir? Aruna Shanbhag.
Mumbai.
She was there in the hospital for more than 35 years. 35 years she was on the bed and hospital people have taken care of her. This section is dedicated to that lady. I feel when I analyze and visualize this section, why this section has been introduced by BNS, it is for such lady, such victim. Aruna Shanba case, this section is dedicated to her IP. She was there in the hospital for 34 years in a vegetative state, and the accused has been enlarged on bail within, I think, 1 month or 2 months, and was there out, acquitted also. But she was there suffering for all these years. So for that, BNS has introduced this new section under section, which is section 66. Now, with regard to the transparency and information rights of victim, BNSS emphasizes victim information rights by ensuring the supply of police reports, FIRs, and witness statements. It also gives provisions dedicated to providing victims with crucial information at various stages of investigation and trial. The two-month timeline is specifically mentioned in 193 subclause 2 of BNSS for offences under section 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 70, 71 of the Bharatiya Nyaya Sanhita. Timeline also added for POKSO Act 2012 to avoid delay in justice to victim. So this timeline is also, yes, complete investigation. This timeline is also induced by the BNSS with regard to the offences against women like rape and other things, and also under POKSO Act. Thereafter, in section 193, subclause 3.2 of BNSS provides that the police official shall, within 90 days, inform the progress of investigation by any means, including electronic communication, to informant of the victim. So this is where a timeline is fixed by the BNSS that a police officer should complete the investigation within 90 days. Likewise, section 398 of BNSS mandates the preparation and notification of a witnesses protection scheme by every state government. It can be indirectly considered as protection to victims. Victim protection scheme is very much important. See, now there are articles which Article 14, Article 19, Article 21, Article 22 of the Constitution give so many rights to the accused. Rights of the accused has been envisaged in our Indian Constitution. As far as the right of the victim is concerned, there is no introduction in either in the Constitution, especially with regard to victim. So now, under BNSS, these all rights, protection, information has been envisaged. So because of these things, we can say that this BNSS, BNS and BSA is victim-centric. Isn't it? Will you agree with me or not? So these are all the rights which has been introduced by the legislation. Now let me conclude with regard to the victim-centric. These new laws are justice-centric. Let us have a look and discussion with regard to how these new laws passed by the parliament are justice-centric. Now I would like to discuss in detail with regard to the other aspects. The BNSS has introduced totally 531 sections spread over 39 chapters, which has replaced the CRPC with 484 sections and 37 chapters. A total of 177 provisions has been changed, that is modified. Totally 177 provisions has been changed and modified, and new 9 sections as well as 39 new subsections have been added to it. Total 44 new provisions and explanations added in this, provisions and provisos. Timelines have been added to 35 sections, and audio video provision has been added at 35 places. Timelines have been added to 35 sections, and audio video provision has been added at 35 places. Total 14 provisions have been deleted in BNSS. Now, what are the major reforms which has been introduced in BNSS? Let us discuss. As I have already stated, that definition clause has been added. If you open BNSS, you will find a definition clause under section 2. The key terms definition is there in BNSS section 2. So if you open the book chronologically, that alphabetically, you will find a sections. If you want to go through any sections, you need not search a whole book. In the outset only, you will have a look with regard to the definitions. For example, act, B, bail. Bail was never defined in CRPC. Like that, C, whatever alphabetically, whatever term, key terms are there in the CRPC or in BNSS, that has been defined under section 2. Thereafter, prosecution related reforms have been introduced. That is, once the registration of FIR investigation will take place, then prosecution will come into play. So prosecution related reforms have been taken place. The already submitted victim centric reforms has also been taken place. Accused rights have been liberalized to some extent in some places. Investigation related reforms are there. Introduction of technology is there. Trial in absentia to deal with proclaimed offenders. Timeline for speedy justice is introduced. Reforms in trial procedures are there. Bail related reforms are there. And other some miscellaneous reforms and some check and balances are also introduced by BNSS. Now let me take in detail with regard to the prosecution related reforms. You know that every state has a director of prosecution. Working under director of prosecution, public prosecutors, senior assistant public prosecutors, assistant public prosecutors are working. Likewise, joint directors are also there. Now, responsibility is given to the director of prosecution, is responsible for giving opinions on filing appeals and monitoring cases punishable with 10 years or more, life imprisonment and death. So the responsibility is vested upon the director of prosecution to give opinion with regard to the case wherein particular case can be appealable or not. So, for which offences he can give opinion with regard to the appeal is, the offences should be punishable with 10 years of imprisonment and life imprisonment or death. So, this is the responsibility of the director of prosecution. Deputy director of prosecution responsible to examine police report and monitor the cases punishable for 7 years or more but less than 10 years. Assistant Director of Prosecution empowered to monitor cases punishable for less than 7 years. The BNSS makes the provision for the central government to appoint public prosecutor or additional public prosecutor for the purposes of prosecution before the Delhi High Court. So this is vested upon the central government. In case of appointment of any other persons in the absence of assistant public prosecutor, the district magistrate is required to give 14 days notice to the state government before making such appointment. So, if in case there is no public prosecutor, you have come across that there is inadequacy of a public prosecutor to conduct the cases, in such circumstances, the power has been vested on the district magistrate to appoint an assistant public prosecutor by giving 14 days notice to the state government. Earlier under section in CRPC, there was a requirement of concurrence of the Chief Justice of the High Court for appointment of a Director of Prosecution or a Deputy Director of Prosecutions. Now that has been omitted. Likewise, section 20 subclause 2 of BNSS create new post of Assistant Director of Prosecutions. Provides that a person shall be eligible to be appointed as assistant director of prosecution and he shall be subordinate to director of prosecutions and deputy director of prosecution. So some certain changes have been brought with regard to the director of prosecution as well as with regard to the appointment of assistant public prosecutors and public prosecutor. Now very very important topic which is under BNSS is investigation related reforms. So what are the reforms which has been carried out by BNSS with regard to the investigation that we will look into? As I have already stated, recognition is given to zero FIR. Did you understand with regard to the zero FIR? Any doubt you have?
After registering the zero FIR, the complainant has to go and sign the original FIR in a span of 3 days.
Yes, exactly, exactly. That
and complaint can be made online.
Yes, yes. Any from anywhere in India.
Anywhere.
Anywhere in India. This is one thing. Thereafter, preliminary inquiry is introduced. Earlier, in CRPC, there was no scope for preliminary inquiry. After the landmark judgment of the Lalita Kumari, this preliminary inquiry has been introduced in BNSS. PCR private complaint and non-cognizable offences. This I will just take in a heading and thereafter I will explain. Visit of forensic experts, victim and witness statements, procedures has been laid down to recording the confessions, medical examination of rape victim, search and seizure, arrest and custody. So, as I have already stated you, once the FIR is registered, the investigation will start. So, what are the procedures has to be adopted by the investigating officer, and what are the reforms which has been brought by the BNSS in the criminal justice system with regard to the investigation? This is in this under this head. Zero FIR, you have very well aware now what is that. Irrespective of the area, orally or by electronic communication, that can be filed by the victim. As I have told, preliminary inquiry. Section 173 subclause 3 of PNSS has given statutory recognition to preliminary inquiry for cases punishable with 3 years or more but less than 7 years. Whenever a FIR is lodged in the police station, if the offence which has made out by the complainant is punishable with 3 years or less than 7 years, then a preliminary inquiry has been made mandatory upon the investigating officers that they have to conduct a preliminary inquiry. So, to avoid filing of frivolous FIR or a fake FIR. And it shall be conducted with the prior permission from an officer below the rank of Deputy Superintendent of Police. So, he has to take a prior permission of the DYSP to conduct this preliminary inquiry. The inquiry shall be carried out within a period of 14 days, cases where there exists a prima facie case. So, there also a timeline is fixed on the investigating officers that they cannot prolong months together to do it, this preliminary inquiry. Within a 14 days of time, he has to conduct a preliminary inquiry. And if there is a prima facie case has been made out by the complainant, then he has to register a FIR. Without prejudice to the provisions contained in section 175, on receipt of information relating to the commission of any cognizable offence, which is made punishable for 3 years or more but less than 7 years, the officer in charge of the police station may, with the prior permission from an officer not below the deputy superintendent of police, considering the nature and gravity of the offence, proceed to conduct a preliminary inquiry to ascertain whether there exists a prima facie case for proceeding in the matter within a period of 14 days. Proceed with investigation when there exists a prima facie case. This is one kind of preliminary inquiry. Now, as far as the private complaint is concerned, you know, private complaint is always under section 200 of CRPC, wherein if in case police are refused to register a FIR, he used to go to the concerned jurisdictional magistrate and used to file a complaint. Now, under section 173 subclause 4, that is earlier sections 154 subclause 3 and 156 subclause 3 of the CRPC provide that the complainant may file an application to the magistrate to register FIR only if the superintendent of police does not investigate the case. Now, directly he cannot go to the magistrate and file a private complaint. He has to go to the superintendent of police if in case the superintendent of police is also refusing to register a case and investigate the case, then he can go and approach the magistrate. Non-cognizable offences. By amending section 155 or the new section 174 of BNSS, Police is required to send information with regard to the non-cognizable offences. You know, we call it as NCR cases. NCR cases, there will be a diary in the police station and they will make it as a NCR case. Now, even if the offence committed by the accused is coming under the purview of non-cognizable offences, the duty is cast upon the police officer to submit a daily diary report to the magistrate. Daily diary, that too timeline is fixed in by the BNSS in this also. The offences to concern on a fortnightly basis, he has to send a report to the magistrate, fortnightly basis. Earlier it was not recognized in CRPC. BNSS has made mandatory visit of forensic experts. So whenever the police officer who is investigating the matter after registration of FIR has to cause these forensic experts to the spot, and they should collect evidence either maybe electronically or digitally. So this has been made mandatory under section 176 of the BNSS. When the police receive information about the crime punishable more than 7 years. So this has been again constrained. If in case the offences committed by the accused are punishable with more than 7 years, then these forensic experts will visit the scene of crime. After that, after collection of evidence from the spot, either by the investigating officer or by the forensic expert, what will be the next course of action of the IO is to record the statement of the witnesses. So this statement under 164.5A of a CRPC was replaced, and section 183.6A of BNSS has been introduced. In this recording of statements, additional safeguards have been provided for recording of statements by a judicial magistrate. As I have already stated, this is a protection given to the victim of rape and all. Woman is giving a such statement, it shall be as far as practicable recorded by a woman only. This is just a safeguard, and it can be recorded video audio also. As far as recording of confessions also, confessions may be either of the accused, it is always accused only, confessions. Exemption from attending the police station is given to woman person. This is also I have already discussed. Then as per 183 victim of rape, that also I have discussed. 176 subclause and statement of such will be through audio video. This is also I have already discussed. Then medical examination of rape victim. Medical examination of a victim of rape under new section 184.6 corresponds to the old section 164A subclause 6 has been time bound by substituting the words 7 days. See, now this the earlier 164A subclause 6 was introduced for the examination of victim of a rape. Now time bound has been fixed that she has to be examined within 7 days. So medical examination need to be done within 7 days without delay. The registered medical practitioner shall old section examination of victim submission immediately. The word is 7 days. The registered medical practitioner shall within a period of 7 days forward the report to the investigating officer, who shall forward it to the magistrate referred to in section 193 as part of the documents referred clause A of subsection 6. That's what she need to be examined within 7 days, and this medical examiner, medical practitioner who has examined the victim of rape is also bound to submit his report within 7 days to the investigating officer. So timeline is fixed to each and everyone. Wherever the person who is assisting the investigation or who is assisting the trial, timeline has been fixed by the BNSS. Now search and seizure. We are very well aware that once the police officer take up the investigation, there will be search and seizure, and also there will be a raid. Under section 165, search conducted under this section shall be recorded through audio, video, electronic means, preferably by mobile phones. Earlier they used to visit the spot and they used to search, they used to seize. But now BNSS has made mandatory upon the police that they have to videograph it videograph, it need not to be from any device, it can be done through their mobile phone also. So such under say 185 of PNSS now need to send to be concerned magistrate within 48 hours, and that search and seizure report should be submitted to the jurisdictional magistrate within 48 hours. They cannot keep it with them. There also timeline is fixed by the BNSS. As per section 103 and 105 of BNSS, recording of search and seizure through audio, video, electronic means, the police officer shall without delay forward such recording to the district magistrate, sub-divisional magistrate or judicial magistrate of the subclass. Like a seizure of proceeds of crime, BNSS also adds new section 107 which gives vast powers of seizure attachment of property. Where police officer making an investigation has reason to believe that any property is derived or obtained directly or indirectly as a result of crime activity or from the commission of any offence, this section gives police the power to have the property of any accused seized, forfeited, if it is suspected to be involved in criminal activity. He may, with the approval of the superintendent of police or commissioner of police, make an application to the court or the magistrate exercising jurisdiction to cognizance of the offences or commit for trial or try the case for the attachment of such property. Now, with regard to the seizure of proceeds of crime, this separate section has been made. See, now the legislature has used a word any property in other sections also. But with regard to seizure of any property, immovable property doesn't count. It is only movable property. With regard to attachment and forfeiture, even immovable property can be attached and forfeited. Alva sir? Yes. It is under section 107, subclause 1 of BNSS. The court of the magistrate may, after considering the explanation, show cause notice issued under subsection 2 and the material fact available before such court or magistrate, and after giving a reasonable opportunity of being heard to such person or persons, may pass an order of attachment in respect of those properties which are found to be the proceeds of crime. So now you can see the safeguard which is given to the accused, opportunity of being heard before attachment of such property. So we can here say that the protection has been given to the accused also, that he should be heard before it is attached or forfeited, which are ascertained from the proceeds of crime, accumulated from the proceeds of crime. Continuing under subclause, if the court or the magistrate finds the attached or seized properties to be proceeds of crime, the court or the magistrate shall by order direct the district magistrate to relatively distribute such proceeds of crime to the persons who are affected by such crime. So affected by such crime is none other than the victim again here. And those the profits which has been accumulated through the proceeds of crime can be distributed to the victim. This is again one more protection given to the victim. Notably, as per the explanation to this section, the word proceeds of crime defined in section 111 of the Act is akin to the definition of the term under Prevention of Money Laundering Act. You know, PMLA Act, proceeds of crime and all, which is in our discussion today. So proceeds of crime, even if it is acquired through the crime, what we call it as a crime, proceed of crime, if it is attached or forfeited by the court by following certain procedures, that crime proceeds can be distributed to the victim also. It cannot be forfeited to the government. One more protection has been given to the victim. Now comes to the arrest and custody. This is also always a hot point for discussion, arrest of the accused. Many judgments are there. Yes, always. So and imprisonment and death 90 days. So in this timeline, the police officer can take the accused for police custody of 15 days in total, even after lapse of initial 15 days. That was not used or admitted in hospitals. You know very well that once in a high profile cases or in any other cases, once the accused is arrested, they are in the habit of taking shelter of the hospitals. So it is very difficult for the police officer to interrogate the accused, taking him into police custody and to unearth the crime and unearth the truth. So to avoid such circumstances, the BNSS has introduced another concept. The philosophy of 167 subclause 2 itself has been changed by the BNSS. It has introduced that even after lapse of first 15 days, the police can take the custody of accused. But that should not be after lapse of 50 days or after lapse of 90 days as the case may be. Now how, once after taking the custody, thank you so much. Introduction of technology is coming into play in BNSS 2023. Now if we see in brief, all trials, inquiries and proceedings with regard to issuance of service and execution of summons and warrant can be done technologically. Examination of complaint and witnesses can be done through audio-video mode. Recording of evidence, inquiries and a trial can also be done through audio-video mode. All appellate proceedings or any other proceedings may be held in electronic mode by use of electric communication or use of audio-video electronic mode since from inception of FIR till the case attains its finality. Now the case will go to a logical end after appeal result has come out. Now BNSS has introduced this technology since from inception of FIR till the conclusion of trial and appeal. So in issuance of the summons, then serving of summons, execution of warrants, everywhere we can use the technology. So section 63 of the BNSS introduces technology compatibility for issuance and service of summons. The court can now issue summons in electronic form authenticated by the image of the seal of the court or digital signature. So this is how technology is coming in into force. Now with regard to serving of summons, section 66 has introduced gender neutrality. It has been introduced and women have been included as an adult member of the family. Earlier it was a male member of the summons ought to have been served on the adult male member of the family. Now this section has made gender neutrality. Even if a adult female member is that, the summons can be woman on summons can be served. In section 227 dealing with issuance of process, the summons and warrants may also be issued through electronic media, digital evidence with regard to it. Then coming to FIR can be given through electronics means to be taken on record within 3 days. Then 161 statements may be recorded through audio video electronic means. Supply of police report and documents can also be done through electronic communication. Summons bearing the image of court seal may also be served by electronic communication. And all other things, whatever, wherever it is possible, a technology can be used by the BNSS, by the courts. That is, this is a radical and a drastic change in BNSS 2023. Now, with regard to the trial, once the investigation is completed, police will file the charge sheet before the concerned court jurisdictional court and a trial will begin, wherein it will be in a categorical, we can say that the trial has begun. So trial, when it is a trial, it is before the court. Now what are the changes which has been brought by the BNSS with regard to trial? All under section 530 of BNSS, all trials, inquiries and proceedings may be held in e-mode by use of communication or use of AV, audio video means. So all trials, inquiries, everything can be done under electronic communication or use of AV means. Prosecution evidence can be digital means and police public can also give evidence through digital evidence. It is not necessary that witnesses need to be attended before the court, need not to be present in the court hall. They can give or depose their evidence from the place where they are through electronic mode. Even accused copy can be given digitally. Framing of charges, reading over of charges can be done all through digital means. Where the accused is in custody and is examined through electronic communication, his signature shall be taken within 72 hours of the examination. To take the signature of the accused, he has to be brought before the court. Otherwise, even a charge can be framed when he was in the jail. So, bringing him to the court is not required. If the accused is in custody, he shall be brought to hear the judgment pronounced either in person or through audio video. He constrains, restraints to visit to the police station also. Even if she doesn't want to visit the police station, there are so many other aspects which will come into her mind before filing the FIR. So, all those things will be taken into consideration by the courts. And once the FIR is lodged and when it has been brought to the knowledge of the investigating officer or a police officer, from that day, her medical examination has to be done within 7 days. And the report of examination has to be submitted by the medical officer also within 7 days. This is the timeline fixed.
ಇದು ಏಷ್ಯಾನೆಟ್ ನ್ಯೂಸ್ ನೆಟ್ವರ್ಕ್ ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತಿ.
ನೀವು ನೋಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀರಾ ಏಷ್ಯಾನೆಟ್ ಸುವರ್ಣ ನ್ಯೂಸ್.